Thank you, Gabriel, for this wonderful introduction. It's just before lunchtime, and I'm the one usually who shows a lot of tables. I cut out a lot of tables, and I try to bring the topic to you as easy as possible, but still, we have some neuroscience to do right now. So it goes into the brain, to networks, it's actually the matter. We have the energy coming in, and we have the information. So three things are needed. Matter, energy, and information. Energy comes from light. Okay, actually I'm coming, I'm a school medicine man, and I'm teaching medical technologies, so it won't work. Does it work? So I'm teaching medical technologies to tell the students, if clients want to measure something, please make the instruments so that they measure what they want to measure, and that it's right, that it's correct measurement. What the therapists do afterwards with this, that's their own freedom. But you have the right that you have exact measurements, so that's what I'm teaching them. So we are quite big, the second largest university of applied sciences in Germany. A lot of professors, a lot of stuff, 35 bachelor's and master's studies. It's ranged from engineering to social science, so we have almost everything here. And my lab, it's in the Department of Applied Sciences and Mechatronics. We have electrophysiology and a light lab. So we are measuring also temporal light artifacts, flicker of LED. I show you an example afterwards here from a colleague. This is the topic where I'm talking today, where I come to. And we have competences in EEG, visual evoked potentials, heart, reaction variation or heart rate variation, skin conductance and impedance cardiography. So what we also measure is vigilance and melatonin suppression of light. So we created some lab environments, and we also created a learn lab with the students with human-centric lighting, learn lights. So I have two main parts of my talk. The first part is the introduction of human-centric lighting, because there are different meanings in the United States and in Europe. There's kind of different, yeah. And in my field, I'm advisor at the ZVEE, at the German Electrotechnical Organization. I'm really focused on the human perspective, not on the energy efficiency perspective. So my deal is the human perspective. So what are IPRGCs? A short explanation. These are new photoreceptors. They discovered it 20 years ago. Then what has to do the light reflex, the pupil light reflex, and what is the clinical property of the pupil light reflex? And then what happens if you stimulate with different colors, or actually I just use it with red and blue, and what can it tell us about the brain? And maybe in the end I show you clinical implication possibilities to use the chromatic papillometry, and then afterwards I can show you some spectra if you want. If you have a light source somewhere and you're interested what's coming out there, we can measure it right online and see it on the screen afterwards. Okay. So, in my view, we had a lot of these things before, because the speakers before, they said it all the same. Humans are adapted to natural sunlight from far on. Yeah, we have daylight, and here is the technical thing, that's a spectrum, that's what I, as a scientist, have to do. I measure it, I put numbers on it. has nothing to do with the information in it. It's just the spectrum. But the spectrum gives information, what is the quantity and somehow the quality of light. And in the evening, we just have campfires, or we had campfires in those days. And you see there's much of a difference than the daylight spectrum from the sunlight and this nice spectrum from a campfire or from a tungsten lamp. So what do we need during the night? What do you think? Next slide. Please recognize the contrast in the blue in the former days. The contrast from the daylight and from heating light. And that's what we need during the night. It's complete darkness. Every application which sends out light during the night, even very low light, can disturb your system and can prevent you from sleeping. So in former days, we had just candles, and then they are out, and then it was dark. And today, we have different situation. We have lights during the night, all the time, 24/7. And we have shift work. And all these poor workers were working in shift work have severe health problems. So we try to deal with it, but one solution could be light, the right light to the right time. And this is actually the essence of human-centric lighting, but actually you saw this before also. What is light? Light for a lighting technician is just the visual part of the optical radiation. Just this part is light. And if you talk about this, this is radiation, and UV is also radiation. So you have to make a difference between radiation and light. So a light planner usually uses this part of the spectrum. And you see, this is the atmosphere, and the atmosphere absorbs a lot. Water, actually water is in your skin, and water absorbs electromagnetic fields. And you see, you heard the 5G presentation. So we are in the optical radiation until here. So it goes from 100 to 1,000 nanometers. And this, there's also the 5G radiation inside there. And there's a lot of observation with H2O, so that's why they won't use these frequencies, because normally water absorbs all this radiation. Also carbon dioxide makes absorbance. Okay, so this was the definition of light, and what does the body use? Actually, we heard before, the body uses all the parts of the optical radiation. I have just brought you some important parts where we, in medicine, already know that this is important. So we have the UVB portion, and it's very important for vitamin D production. You saw a slide before. And we need UVA also. We can't put on sun protection, but as Professor Kropotov said, or somebody else, not more than 10, because we need the UVA also, yeah, for immune modulation. It's very important. Then we have the visual spectrum, and lighting planners usually today just plan with the visual spectrum, but we have also non-visual effects, and these non-visual effects I will explain to you. That is what we want to integrate with human-centric lighting in the normal lighting. And then we have infrared A, and it's very important for healing and regeneration, and also protection of blue light hazard, which is a special hazard to your eye if you have a lot of blue content in the radiation. So actually, infrared A protects from blue light hazard. It's quite new in medicine. Maybe you know it since longer days. But we have to quantify it, and now they quantified it. And actually, it's different from heat. If you put heat on a tissue, you get more free radicals. If you put heat and UVA in a tissue, you get less free radicals. So it has a protection effect. So we probably might need it also in artificial lighting. Okay, so the last 20 years, there was a lot of effort in the neuroscience of light, And one of the biggest players are the researcher in chronobiology. So what I can measure with my spectrometer and with lux meters and so on, it's just a static view of the light. But we need a dynamic view. The light is changing during the day. It's like the same, you described the quality of the water just with these numbers. There's no information telling you. Or you have a sonat from Mozart, and you just give the frequencies and say, oh, this is the frequency, this is Mozart. But the information is lost. So we have a lot of information coming from the sun, telling the body what time it is, how the hormones should be suppressed or not suppressed in the body, how the endocrine system works, how the autonomic innervation, sympathetic and parasympathetic, works. And we have peripheral tissues. Some are connected directly from the brain, so the lung and the heart. You see it with the heart frequency variation, or the heart rate variation. And we have the liver and other organs. The big organs usually have nerves. But what about the immune system? What about the immune cells? They don't have nerves, but they get the information also, and mainly through melatonin and other hormones. Hormones are produced also in peripheral tissues, give a feedback in the brain. The brain gives a feedback to the peripheral tissue that you always have the right measure of hormones. So this is very important. And the system biology regulates the sleep-wake cycle, the feed-fast cycle, and your vigilance. And if you sleep during the day, or if you cannot sleep during the night, if you have problems. So this is all a matter of chronobiology. Okay, so light is the important connection between the environment and your inner systems. And we have one major clock in the brain. It's connected to the eye, and this is the conductor of the concert. Every cell in our body has own clocks, and they are ticking their own frequency. But they need, like in a concert, they need a conductor who gives the takt, gives the pace. So this conductor is the SCN. It's a small part of the brain, suprachiasmatic nucleus. I explain you afterwards what this is. So, and this gets innervated by light directly from the eye. Nothing from tissue, directly from the eye. Also nothing from the ear. It's directly from the light, which comes into your eye, also through the closed eyelids. Okay, this is the main conductor, and it controls the other organs. And if there is something wrong, the organs play like a concert which has no conductor. Okay, so the question, what is human-centric lighting in Europe? Human-centric lighting means integrative lighting. So we want to integrate the standards we have already with lux and lumen and so on, but there's a lot more. There's colors, there's timing, and all what you do and what you use in your healing praxis, yeah? It's an integrative part of the light we want to design. So we need the experience from you all to bring it in there, and also from the architects to really make good visual light, and to bring in the knowledge from the chronobiologists and the brain research. So that was the combination. Is we want to combine the visual effects, intensity, contrast, patterns, movements, cognition, information, with the non-visual effects of light, the circadian rhythm, the control of the circadian rhythm, the inner clocks, the control of inner clocks, control of hormones, activation, vigilance, and this together. If this is in a flow, that's what you heard before, then you have the state of well-being. If there's a disrupted flow, then you won't sleep in the night and you are tired during the day. And seniors may fall over the simple thing and break something. It's very expensive. So let's come to the ophthalmologist. Is there an ophthalmologist here somewhere? He might, yeah. You too. Please don't kill me. Because the ophthalmologist said, there is no thing we don't know in the eye. And at the year 2000, there was the publication of new photoreceptors. And the ophthalmologist said, it's Hamburg, it's bogus. It's not true. There is actually a special photoreceptor in the eye. We have it right now. This is the scientific reports. It was parallel done in the States by George Brainard from NASA research and from Deborah Skeen from the Center of Chronobiology in Surrey. And the doctoral student was Kavita Tapan. And they describe an action spectrum of an, until that, unknown photoreceptor. So it has not really much to do with vision. It controls the non-visual system in your body. Okay? So let's go on. What is this for a special photoreceptor? So we have an eye here. This is the optical nerve going out. Then we have the ganglion cells here, which are connected between bipolar cells and the photoreceptor. These are the classical photoreceptors. These are ciliary photoreceptors. This is just for the medicals. Ciliary photoreceptors are later in the evolution. They come later. And in very former days, mollusks and flies and so on have special photoreceptors, and they are in the ganglion cells. They're just in the ganglion cells, and they called rhabdomeric photoreceptor. So in the beginning, it was just rhabdomeric, and in the evolution, we got the ciliary, which was more precise, which really gets every photon. This is really some kind of sluggish response, but it has survived in the human eye, actually from a fly. So we are somehow connected to the flies, at least in the eye. Okay, and those special receptors here in the ganglion cells, they are not many, 3 to 5%. They are spread in the retina. They called an opsin. It's a similar opsin than the ciliary receptors, and it's called melanopsin. So it's different, and it's also in the flies and in the mollusks and in fishes and so on. So we have this really old photoreceptor, and they discovered it. And what can we do with this knowledge? Okay, this is a retinal ganglion cell with synapses. So this is in the eye. And you see the dots here. This is interconnected with the other receptors. And all those thousands and thousands and thousands interaction make the information or combine the information to a kind of image in your brain. And then the other millions and millions and millions of nerve cells make the feelings, and other billions, billions make actions. So we never know what they all are doing. So that's why I just try to describe these ones and the ones with the special receptors. The ones with the special receptors, these 3%, they use more energy. They need more because they have an additional receptor. So if you have a problem in the eye where the energy is not good supported, like glaucoma and diabetes, those guys, they get killed at the beginning. So we have somehow a clue to check it if there is an early stage disease coming on. So these are the ganglion cells, and this is a spectrum of daylight, and you see this prominent, it's 8 o'clock in the morning from a hotel room, and you see this prominent peak between 490, 480, 500, something like this. This is from the sun. And we have the visual effects, and all the lighting technicians, they measure lux, lumen, candela per square meter. Everything is measured just because of the brightness. And the brightness was done in 1923 with 26 persons. They said, is it the same brightness or is it different brightness? And they found out this efficiency curve. So everything which is under this curve defines the brightness of a light. And if you count for energy efficiency, everything which is under here is energy efficient by definition, because it's measured in lumen and lux. And everything which is outside here is waste of energy. Right now, that's the law. So we abandon all this nice lighting because of we just accept that this is the light we need. But the humans need more. So at least the IPRGCs has a funny thing. Actually, the peak where the blue light in the morning is the most intensity. So the evolution made this nice photoreceptor with a peak in the blue. So that's what you need in the morning to synchronize your system. Okay, so this is actually a short video. Try to start it. Shortly
explained. Let us follow a beam of light into the eye. After the light has passed through the cornea and lens, and then the jelly-like vitreous body, it falls on the retina.
See something?
There are different layers of cells here. The uppermost layers consist of ganglion cells and nerve cells that form connections. Below this lie the rods and cones. These are the receptors that are responsible for vision.
It's just vision.
The incoming light triggers a nerve impulse that is routed back to the surface of the retina. From here, it is then transmitted via the optic nerve along the visual pathway to the visual cortex. This is part of the cerebral cortex and is where our visual impression emerges from the multitude of data provided by the retinal receptors. Now back to the ganglion cells that contain melanopsin. These are located between other ganglion cells in the upper layers of the retina. When stimulated by a light impulse, the nerve impulse follows a different pathway from that used by the rods and cones. It initially also follows the optic nerve out of the eye. However, these nerve fibers do not lead to the cerebral cortex. They interconnect in the so-called suprachiasmatic nucleus, two grain-sized nuclei. This control center constitutes the internal clock in humans. This clock also controls the pituitary gland, sends out hormones that regulate intrinsic rhythms within the body and align metabolic processes with the time of day. Other nerve pathways run to activation centers in the brain and to control centers in the spinal cord, to the pineal gland, and to the hypothalamus. Together, these nuclei control many vegetative processes, in other words, unconscious processes, in the body via neural stimuli and hormones.
Okay, this was a short introduction on the visual and... Thank you very much. It was a short introduction on the visual pathway and the non-visual pathway. It's quite different. And if you remember those tiny yellow ways, pathways, if you multiply it by milliards, then you know what in the brain is going on, but you cannot explain it on the slide. Okay, good. So we have those newly discovered cells. Just a wrap up. We have light coming in from the outside in the morning maybe, goes to your visual cortex, and gives you the information on what is this object, what color is it, how is it shaped. And then we have this retinohypothalamic tract, which is a separate pathway from the IPRGCs, which connects directly to the master clock, to the SCN. So it's connected here, and from there, there are also a lot of other inputs, inputs from gastrointestinal, so when you eat, gets an impulse up here. When you get up, when you lay down in the evening, when you sleep, gets all the information to the master clock. And the master clock tries to regulate over a sympathetic network, goes down the neck, goes up again to the pineal gland. And the pineal gland releases melatonin, your sleep hormone, during the night. And if you have blue light in the night, then it's immediately stopped. So it's about 10, 15 minutes and the melatonin decreases and your system gets the information, hey, it's day, you have to get up, you have to be awake. So you don't know what has happened, but a display like this can do it in the evening. Okay. So we have the entrainment circuit is slower than the vigilance circuit, and we had the activation circuits in the brain which gives us the activation properties of light. So these main actions are triggered by non-visual effects, and we can measure it, and there was publications done with PET and fMRI that you see immediate responses in the brain where activation centers are. So light is activating in your brain. And also the long-term synchronization is done with the melatonin cycle, the black bars. This is the night where no light is usually. And this is the rise of melatonin during the night. It's high. During the day, it's almost not measurable. It's high. And it's really dependent where you are on the planet. It's different in California, and it's different here. So that's why we have this problem with the alignment, because our inner clock, the SCN, these cells, they're not precise, not at all. These are hormones, and these are just structures of nerve cells and biochemical clocks. So you have to entrain them daily with best daylight or with artificial light, which contains a lot of this blue part in there. Then we get the entrainment and feel good. And if we have travel by jet or traveling transcontinental, then you have probably from Pula to California a very long day, and then you come on in the night and it's dark and you are really awake. You think, oh, what can I do? I make my presentation for tomorrow, and then I'm in the presentation room the next day, and it's dark and it's fur and it's silent, and I just fall asleep, and I had actually a talk to give. So that's what your hormones do with you. And if you go out and if you expose yourself to the sun in the morning, then you easily get adopted to the new area, to the new place. So, and this is the importance of human-centric lighting, because we want to integrate in the commercial lighting the combination of radiance, spectrum, solid angle of a light source, and the timing information. This is the information, the right light to the right time, because our clock has distinct abilities. We are very fit in the afternoon physically. We have high alertness in the early afternoon, and in the morning and the evening, we are so la-la. And in the night, the body usually wants to sleep. Okay, so what can actually this human-centric lighting do? Maybe with shift workers or with transcontinental personnel, can stabilize your hormonal rhythms, enhance melatonin release during the night, because if you have a lot of light during the day, you have more melatonin in the night. And that's why you probably, if you are in Pula and you're lying all day on the beach, and you just do nothing, just lie on the beach, you are really tired in the evening. You go to bed and sleep so well. Yeah, because you have a lot of melatonin covered up during the day. So improve sleep and regeneration, enhance resilience and against stress, less chronic disruption from artificial light, and also it can act like antidepressive agent and can activate you when it should do, and it should calm you down when you should be calm. So there's a lot of also publications about light therapy for depression, and if you compare medication with light therapy, you won't get these effects with the medication with instead of light therapy. So the effect size usually from medication is 0.2 to 0.5. With light we have 0.8. 80% of the persons react on light if you have the right light to the right time. So bright light acts like an antidepressant. So you have also alerting effects of light. Christian Kajochen is the head of the chronobiology in Basel. He published his studies that confirm the role of the non-image-forming system of alertness. Okay. Light is a stimulant to your brain. That's what the science says. Okay. Then we conduct a lot of studies, and all the studies, you know, get put together to a review report, and the highest evidence in medicine is Cochrane reports. It's the highest evidence. And if they say there's no effect, everybody in medicine cannot neglect this. So what do they say? There's insufficient evidence to recommend the use of bright light therapy in dementia. Everybody who built light for dement people saw an immediate effect. They really identify pictures very good. They are more alert, but you cannot measure it. That's why there's no effect, and that's why we cannot apply it but I have 20 minutes more because because I started later. So please wait with the lunch. So you get no effect, and that's why we cannot apply it in hospitals and senior housings. No official from the community can say, okay, we want this, because there is no effect, because you cannot measure it. So that's the problem. And this is actually, this was from a big company in Munich, lighting company, starts with O and ends with Rum. They paid a lot for studies and nothing came out. What's the reason behind? Because the nurses, they all react perfectly. They slept better, they are more vigilant, wonderful, yeah, but not the elderly people. So we have to think about, okay, maybe we can make a screening who is sensitive actually for light. And there's a publication from Sama Hatta in his group from Jennifer Ecker, and they found out the IPRGCs in the eye, they stimulate the circadian clock, you know already, and they stimulate the pupillary constriction. So to measure melatonin suppression during the day is not possible. You have to do it during the night. It's very expensive. I did it a long period of time, and many times it was really amount of money. And pupillary constriction, it's easy to measure. Okay, then we thought, okay, are there publications? And they also support spatial vision. Okay, then they found out, okay, there are not just one IPRGC, there are five IPRGCs. And with the three ones here, 2, M4, M5, we actually don't know what they do. They have to do something with spatial vision, but very roughly, very roughly. And the M3 is unknown, and we have the M1 type, and actually one axon goes to the SCN, to the clock, and one axon goes to the pupillary control region. And the cells just differentiate between one factor, one transcription factor. And this transcription factor, this is done with mice. They cloned mice without cones and rods, just the IPRGCs. And then they cloned mice with BRN positive and BRN3B negative. And they saw there's a pupillary reaction with this one, and there's a pupillary reaction with, there's no pupillary reaction, almost no pupillary reaction with this type of IPRGCs. So the negative goes to the circadian photoentrainment, and the other one goes to the pupillary reflex. These are the same cells, same pathway. So we can use the chromatic pupillometry to check the cells, if the chromatic cells are working, because just depend on this one transcription factor. So overview for you, if you want to read it, we have parts in vision, we have control of the circadian clock, and we have control of the pupillometry, the sympathetic and parasympathetic reaction. These are the key points, and the key points, I said already, five types are characterized, and the impressing thing is that the post-illumination pupil response is a promising non-invasive behavioral marker of IPRGC activity. So it was 2013, so the pupil reflex shows us, are these cells are working or not in elderly people. Okay, So let's go to the pupillary light reflex. We have two parts. We have two muscles, the sphincter pupillae, which goes very quick, and it's from parasympathetic nerves innervated. We have the dilatator pupillae. It's sympathetic, and it's wide in dim light, and in bright light it's a quick reaction from parasympathetic, and then the sympathetic let this go back again. And it depends on what it expects. Does it expect bright light, then it goes not that far back? And if it expects no bright light, then it goes really fast, wider. So the thing here is, don't try to understand this slide. It just tells you there is a consensual effect. If you stimulate on one eye, you see the pupil reaction on the other eye. So that's what we use in the technical appliance. So a consensual effect, a direct effect, you see this on a direct eye and also on the consensual eye. And this is the post-illumination pupil response. We have this quick parasympathetic action, constriction of pupil, and then if you shut out the light, so if you stop the light here, and the pupillary reaction goes back, and this is innervated by the dilatator, so this is innervated by sympathetic nerve fibers. So it's your sympathicus going on. And if your sympathicus is really agile, so you like a person, the pupils get white. If you don't like a person, okay. So we have this, and don't understand this picture. It just tells you there's a parasympathetic way here, and there's a sympathetic way, goes down to the neck, and goes up to the cranial ganglion, and goes to the pupillary nerve again. And the same pathway goes from the visual system to the circadian clock, to the SCN. So it's the same pathway, goes up the neck, goes to the pineal gland, and the same nerves go up and go to the eye, to the sympathetic innervation. It's not really the same type, different ones. Okay, so this was a first publication from Cardon, and he said, okay, if you stimulate with blue, there's a different effect than you stimulate with white, and you have the same illuminance, same candela per square meter. So it's quite a different in the reaction of the pupil. The sustained response is much higher with the blue light. Okay, then we said, okay, as a researcher, we want to have this results also. We have to replicate studies, otherwise they're not valid. So we tried to replicate, we looked for instruments, there was nothing to buy, just experimental stuff. So we built a research equipment, it's a demonstrator, where we have a light source with blinking lights here, and this is actually a webcam, a high-solution webcam, where we put in the video signal and we see the consensual lighting reflex. So we tested this with a young, healthy person, and we designed a video processing software, and we could see almost the same with our system than the system from the Cardon protocol. So this is a publication which shows really that we can separate rods and cones from the melanopsin response. So the melanopsin response is the pupil dilation in the blue, and it's much longer because the system, if you give a blue light, the system thinks it's day and it's bright, so I don't dilate that much. So it stays like this. And if you just stimulate with red, red says no circadian stuff, it's just light. And it goes back, it goes white again. So you see a really distinct difference in the post-illumination pupil response. And we did a protocol where we stimulate with the same luminance. And then we found out that we have to make the same radiance because luminance is not the right measure for it. Thank you. 50, I always have some minutes more. So, to just to understand what we did, so we separated the edge detection and we put some dots in, then we can estimate in a time frame the pupil size. So we did this in a time series with three red stimulation and with three blue stimuli. And then we have a lot of artifacts because the person blinks with the eye and so on. So this is signal processing. We have to deal with this. And finally, we did averaging. When you see the really nice difference between a young, healthy person and a young, healthy person. So we also programmed some LabVIEW, and you see with five, with the averaging of five persons, you see really a nice difference in young and healthy persons. Also, we the next test we did with six persons, 1 second blue flash and 1 second red flash, you always see this nice difference in blue and red. And then we made a master, and we could describe it by number. This is for the scientists very important. So we created this kind of sheet where you can really see, is it okay or is it somehow impaired with diabetes, glaucoma, high pressure of the eye is glaucoma, or cataract. Then we altered clinical pupillometer to measure also in the clinics. Otherwise, with a demonstrator, we cannot measure it. It's too dangerous. And we designed a hardware for research. So this is also a light dome from Carl Ryberg, which is actually very good. I really like it. But we put something different in here, a stepper motor, which goes through and measures, and a shutter with shuts out the light. So we can program it. That's engineers. We have to do this. OK, so this is the setup. And now we have done a very interesting thing. We found in one study with five persons there was a sex difference between male and woman. And so maybe a mistake, we don't know. And then we measured 50 young, healthy persons, and we found a difference in the sensitivity of the eye. What you see here is a spectrum. We stimulate with the Ryberg monochromator from 780 until red, until from 380 until 695 nanometer. This is the wavelength here. And you see a distinct reaction of the pupil. And what the pupil tells us is it's going not through the V lambda curve, through the visual curve. It's dependent on the IPR she sees. And we have a difference in man and woman. And probably everybody from us is different in a certain way. We have indicated here's certain points where we don't know why the difference is so big, but it's statistically significant difference. So what can you use it for? Diabetes, autonomic neuropathy, screening, early detection of changes in the eye before you lose your eyelid, very early. Retinitis pigmentosa, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's disease, evaluation. You can measure the circadian function in the pupillary light response, because in the afternoon, the pupil is wider. And in the morning, the pupil is more narrow. And that's can measure. And then you know when does the melatonin usually starts. 2.4 hours after the end of the decretion is there. Also, when the dilatation starts, 2 hours later, melatonin starts in an individual person. So you can easily detect chronobiological rhythms. So there's a quite new publication, 2019 this year, and you can assess it for almost all retinal and optic nerve diseases. So this is a control person and this is a glaucoma person. So you see the difference. You just have to need numbers and you have to need standards, and then you can do early stage screening if the circadian system is okay. Okay, and this is a special case with one student had colored contact lenses and we did not see a difference. and then they take out the colored lenses, and you see a very good difference. So the colored lenses make some distraction, lesser distraction, but it disturbs the circadian system. So what you have is cataract, it also disturbs your circadian system, so you have to repair it either with one eye, then it's fine. And you can also put yellow lenses in, does not matter. Your circadian signal reacts also with the green portion of the spectrum. So finally, I am at the end, it's 12:56. I have my watch here. I have actually 15 minutes, but we can stop it here. And I want thank you for your attention, because this is science stuff and it's really boring sometimes. Okay. Okay, this was my hometown area, and you see this nice lake here with the bluish color, this is very good. And here you see my time, and I have an offer for you, because you're doing practically something with light. I have a spectrometer here. Here we can measure almost everything. This is wireless, transmitted to the screen, and what you can see is kind of different spectra. This is the background noise of the light. If it's dark, I have here the lid on, yeah, it's dark. And if you have a light source, please bring it to me, I can measure it, and you can see what's inside this light, what portions. And I have some examples. I have to start this thing, has to do a calibration circuit. So if you have some light source, please come here. Then you see it, what the effect is during the night, probably, if you read your... Then you probably may see what the effect is if you read it during the night, or your children read the smartphone during the night, what it does with your chronobiology. You can see it here, if you want. Just bring a phone, or you can also do the lamp. Yeah. Now I have to connect it. So, dark calibration. So I do like interactive systems. So I connected it wireless here, and now I switch over to this. You have also a nice phone. Can you make it bright? As bright as possible. So I can show you in the beginning the spectrum in here. Maybe. What you see is this. What is this? What you see is this. What is this? This is a typical warm LED spectrum. And if you use glasses where you filter out colors, then you see it much different if you are in daylight, or if you are in good LED light or in bad LED light. So it makes a difference. So this is a LED light. I can show you. I can show you daylight. This is daylight. I measured it just before outside. This is daylight. Has almost every portion of the spectrum inside, and the blue peak. And just a second. And I have brought some others. Okay. It's also daylight. What is this? Fluorescent lamp. Yeah. If you measure with your glasses in the ditches in between, you won't measure anything. It's very low. There's nothing going through. So what you need is a really good light with all the spectrum, and otherwise you cannot compare. This is measurement technology. And let's see what the iPhone does. Do you read? Have you WhatsApp or something on it? If you read WhatsApp? The night. So we measure WhatsApp. Okay. This is a typical 3-color LED monitor. Has a strong peak in the blue, makes you awake during the night, especially the kids. They should not have iPhones or smartphones in the evening or later than 9. Should not. Yeah, night shift mode. This should protect. Okay. You see, the blue portions is radically reduced. So night shift mode is something good. In the beginning, there was just Android phones who had this night shift mode. Or my computer at home has this F-Lux, it's for free, and it dims down if you work at night, otherwise you cannot sleep afterwards. And I tell it to my students, and they really say, hey, I get up in the morning easier, much, much easier when I use this technology, just reduce the blue light when I work in the evening or work in the night. Because then they have a time, maybe 1 hour they cannot sleep, they think about problems, and they said, oh, this was a hard problem. It's your circadian system which is disrupted. And if they use efflux for free, then they go to bed, and in between 15 minutes, they sleep. This white dot, because I have to start it here. Still plenty of the blue. Still plenty of the blue inside. Yeah, they are edge filters, and sometimes the edge filters are too far in the blue. So you see a nice edge filter, 430 or something, but it's not in the circadian. No, no, it doesn't matter. Not much. Okay, the red one. You want to see the red one, okay. Can you keep it, the instrument? Okay, then we measure the red one. This is just red. This is the old one. So here we have the red portion of the smartphone. It's quite nice, narrow banded, and you don't have any blue portion. So what's happening with those things? You can measure each lamp or also the lamps on the iPhones, and don't use it if you want to sleep because these lamps are distracting your circadian rhythm. This has other problems with temporal light artifacts where the flicker. I did not mention flicker. We did a lot of studies with flicker and impairment of the brain and EEG with flicker. We want to get rid of this flicker stuff, and we want to put in the right light to the right time. That's my final sentence. You can go for lunch. Thank you very much for
no
patience.
No questions, sir.
Sorry, the application the for free is for PCs and Macs and all computers. F-Lux. F-L-U-X. You can download this. It's a nice chronobiology site, and it dims automatically your computer, dependent on where you live and where the sun goes up and where the sun goes down. So after the sun goes down, it dims the blue portion away.